who have asked God to change your life. Because we've been out on the street, we've been talking to folk, and folk have been coming and trying to get themselves back together. I want you to know that there is a way to recover your life. And God is going to show you, God is going to help you to get your life together. You can recover.
Amen.
I can recover. Say that with me. I can recover. Say that with me. I can recover. Man, you can get past anything. If you want to change your life, it doesn't matter what you have done. You can change your life. You can live better. You can not only be saved. You don't even have to know what saved is. We'll get to that later. You ain't got to know what saved is. All you got to know is that there is a way for you to change your life for the better. And that way is in the name of Lord Jesus Christ. And whether you know him or not, if you're just here to learn how to get things back on track, God is also here. God already knows what you're dealing with. And God already knows how to help you get it together. And that, my friends, is how you regain faith in God. If God does something for you that you couldn't do for yourself, that is how God gives you faith to trust him the next time. Can I get a good amen like that? Anybody ever been messed up? My wife, my daughter, puts up on Facebook yesterday, and I say, well, Chuck's is out there now. Might as well go on with it. I was flying down the highway in the rain, and I was changing lanes, and all of a sudden I hit something slip. I felt the car going before it went, and I said, oh, no. And the car began to spin and spin and spin at about 68 miles an hour. We were spinning. I don't know how many cars were around us, but nothing touched us. So I left all the weeds and the grass and stuff all over the car as a reminder. Yeah. I came here this morning doing 17 miles an hour. Panic at all. We got to spinning. I said, help us, Jesus, because I thought we were going to hit those concrete columns that hold up the overpass bridge. I thought the car was going to spin right into it. But I said, help us, Jesus. And it got to spinning and spinning. It just stopped facing in the opposite direction. Nobody hit us. And we didn't hit anyone. Somebody came and pulled us out. And my wife signed it and cost us anything to do that. So I said, well, praise God, because I didn't know she had AAA. I was going to call Mercedes. You know, she called and they got us out of there. And I looked at the car, had weeds all over it. Mud all up under the thing. Here I am out there looking around. I said, Tom, we got all this mud on the car. You know, it's stupid. And then I came to myself and said, oh, thank you, Jesus. We're alive. So I realized that we were in shock. I was in shock or something, right? All right. But God is good.
Prepare your Bible to Jeremiah chapter 1.
Thanks, Ron. I know it's not you.
So, John chapter 5, I'm going to read verses 5 through 8. Then prepare your Bible to Jeremiah chapter 1, verses 4 through 10. And then we're going to refer to 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 7. Now, you let me finish this because we want to start, we're going to get into a completely different part of it when we get back here. John chapter 5, beginning at verse 5 through verse 8. Now watch this. And a certain man was there, same one from last week, which had an infirmity 38 years. How long now?
38 years.
See. And when Jesus saw him lie and knew that he had been now a long time in that case, he said unto him, will you be made whole? Then the impotent of the sick man answered him and said, sir, I don't have a man, when the water is troubled, to put me into the pool. But while I am coming, another steps down before me.
Yes.
Then Lord Jesus said unto the man, in verse 8, he said, rise, take up your bed, and walk.
Amen.
So that's the series, the mini-series title is Rise and Be Made Whole.
Amen.
Rise and then be made whole. And now, if you're just joining us and you missed the introduction to this message on last week, this teaching, well, this story is the account of a person, or it's an account of a man who had been sick for a whole, you know, for a number of years. His condition, and I'm glad to say, his condition is not named. But what we do know is that the guy was debilitated. The guy was unable to walk. In other words, he was obviously at the mercy of other people to carry him around because of his condition. Other folk had to take him around in his mind because of his condition. He, like so many other broken and sick folk, he was at the mercy. You know, he was at the mercy of other folk, and there he was at this pool waiting and hoping for a miracle. He was there, waiting on a miracle. He was waiting on a mending, if you will. He was waiting on a healing at the pool, like everybody else that was around that pool. You know, the first person to get into the water, when the angel would come down and stir the water, that person, tradition has it, would be healed or be made well. Now notice now, he was around the pool, and guess who was around the pool with him? A whole lot of other sick folk, just like he was.
Yes.
See? So he was surrounded by folk who were in the same shape that he was in. Do you get it? Do you get it? All right. So we ended our study last time with verse 7. This man, making excuses for his inability to be the first person to get this out of the water, you know, when the angel showed up, this cat laid there like everybody else, looking somewhat despondent. I'm waiting for somebody to get me here, and I wonder what's going to happen when the angel does show up. Now, please be reminded of verse 5. That this man had been sick for 38 years. Anybody follow me?
Amen.
Subsequently, or therefore, he had made excuses for 38 years. You know, that's a long time to be sick, ain't it? That's a long time to be going through. That's a long time to be broken. And all the time, the only thing you got to say for it is that I ain't got nobody to put me in. So that means that for 38 years, you have made one excuse after another excuse as to why you're in the sickness you're in. Well, why he couldn't get into the water first and be healed was in his mind that there was nobody there to help him. I like the King James version of Lord Jesus' question to this guy in verse 6, where the Lord asked him, will you be made whole? Or do you want to be mended? Or do you want to be made complete? You know, because Captain said that for 38 years, you know, do you really want to be? I thought it was a rhetorical question. At first, I thought it was just rhetoric, you know. Why would the Lord ask him a question like that? But then I realized that a lot of times folk are in condition that they're in because either they don't know that they can be better or they don't want to be better. They sort of like it teens. Well, the Lord asked him, do you want to be complete? And I think that King James said it well, because I think the way he asked that question, it fits some of our situation today. There are a whole lot of broken people. There are a whole lot of folk. Maybe you're not sick, but you got a lot of stuff wrong in your life. Like I used to have, I ain't got nothing wrong with me now. But I used to have a lot of broken things in my life, you know, that, you know, broken dreams, broken relationships. Maybe some of you all have some of that. You got a broken state of mind. But let me tell you something. Ain't nothing worse than having a disturbed mind. Can I talk to you a bit?
Yeah.
I don't mean you're crazy. I mean you can't sleep at night. You can't rest.
Yeah.
You are diseased about your life. And conversely then, there's nothing greater than a person can have than peace of mind.
Yeah.
Ain't nothing better than being laid out at night, put your head on the pillow, and leave it. Can I get a witness there?
Yeah.
When so many people are troubled today, you'll wonder if there is a source of peace in this world. And yes, there is. But there are a lot of broken people. People got broken lives. You know, one thing is happening after another. And they just don't, you know, just don't seem like they can get things together. They think they get it together. And then the next thing you know, it's broken again.
Yeah.
There's a lot of brokenness. There's a lot of brokenness going around. And watch this. The motivating factor within this story that Lord Jesus tells is, first off, number one, Lord Jesus' question. It's the first motivating factor. It is, do you want to be made whole? See, the implication being perhaps that the man's inability to be healed or to make or to be made whole had really nothing, if anything at all, little to do with it or anything at all with him getting into that water. If the Lord said, do you want to be whole? Do you really want to be whole? Seems to me like it ain't got nothing to do with the water.
It appears that the man being healed or being made complete was a mind thing. It was not a water thing. It was a mind thing, or it was an attitude adjustment that God needed, you know, if he wanted to be healed. So that means that if you're not healed, man, for the Lord to ask him, do you really want to do it? Must mean that God was looking into this cat's head, trying to see, where are you right now in your debilitated state? Where are you in your brokenness? Where do you stand today? Where, while you're going through what you're going through, where is your head? Where are you emotionally while you're suffering through whatever it is that you're suffering through? Yeah. And I think sometimes that's something we need to have. A whole lot of folk are looking for peace in all the wrong places. Folk are sucking down pills. They're self-medicating with alcohol. Drugs of all kinds. We poke our fingers in the eye of crackheads and all kinds of other addicts, but there's a whole lot of folks taking pills that your doctor is writing for you. See, but we're taking all kinds of stuff, just trying to drown the pain or trying to ease our hurt. Yeah. Anybody ever been there? Yeah. So people go through a lot of things just trying to get themselves together. You see, so it seems like the Lord is saying, before this cat will ever be healed anyway, it ain't the water, it's got to be healed. So it's an attitude thing. Please get part one and continue with the rest of that story. Well, the second motivating factor to this man's completeness is in verse 8, when Lord Jesus responds to the guy's excuse for not being able to get into this water. The Lord said, rise, which implies that the man had the ability to get up. Yeah. You've been out 38 years, and the first thing Lord Jesus tells the guy is to get up. It's nuts, ain't it? It's nuts, ain't it? You can go ahead and say, what is it? Yeah. It's nuts for him to have been laying there for 38 years, and the Lord look at the guy and tells him, get up. Which says immediately, must be, you must have the ability to get up, and if you ain't getting up, the water ain't going to help you, it's you. Now that's just what Lord Jesus said. That's what Lord Jesus said. Now, but watch this. Could it have been, watch this now. Now this is where the message, I think, in this story hopefully finds us today. Could it have been that the man was so intent on getting a miracle? I want to make sure I get this right. Could it have been that he was so bent on getting a miracle that he didn't realize that he had the ability to help himself? Amen. Could it have been that he was so bent on somebody else helping him?
Yeah.
On a governmental change.
Yes.
That a law would be passed.
Yes.
That the mailman would run. Come on, y'all got to come. Waiting on AANA, could he have been looking for a miracle and failed to see that he had his own inner strength, his own ability to get himself together?
Mm-hmm.
He was looking for somebody else to do it,
yeah.
And because he was so bent on somebody else helping him, he failed to see that he had the ability to help himself.
Amen.
Can I get a good amen right there?
Yeah.
Let me tell you something, I ain't no mission field. Can I spit a few words? I ain't no mission field for nobody. You ain't got to send no missionaries down to me to help me get my life straight. This is my life. Listen to me. This is my life. Watch this. I have a mess in my life. It took me a long time to mess it up, and I knew it was going to take me some time to get it together. A whole lot of folks tried it. My parents tried it. They prayed for me, anointed me, grieved me down and all. But until I decided that I was going to change my own life, ain't nothing happened. That you're in. Nobody wants to be in a failed condition. I didn't want to be in one, and I'm certainly not saying that you want to be in a failed condition as well. You're not idiots. You're not stupid. If you're hurting, you don't want to hurt unless you're some kind of sadist. You want to be well, but a lot of times we don't know how to be well. See, but folks, Sometimes you can be down for so long. You've been dealing with stuff for so long, going through something for so long with such little or no result, that sometimes it just gets you to the, you get to the point where you lose hope or you give up on ever being able to get your life together. Every time you try it, something else comes up and knocks you down. Every time you think you have excelled and gotten a little further down the road, something knocks you back. So sometimes when you've been knocked back and you've been down so long, you don't even know how you can get up. And so the only thing you can rely on is if I don't get a miracle, or if somebody has not come to my rescue and bail me out of where I am, I don't see how I can ever recover. Now let me tell you something. I know that that can happen. But before I even go on any further with my cheat sheet, let me tell you this now. That is simply just a trick from the enemy to make you give up on life. And I'm going to show you why in just a moment. Because it is already there. You can recover. I can recover. I don't care what the devil says. I don't care how bad it looks for me. I don't care what shape I'm in. I can recover. Say it with me. I can recover. Say it with attitude. The first step, you coming out knowing that you can recover. Right. 38 years is a long time that this man looked and hoped for a miracle, and it didn't come. And it doesn't mean that he didn't put forth some kind of effort, you know, to be whole, but the story makes it clear that in his mind, his wholeness was in that water. His wholeness was getting into the pool, and then someone else perhaps putting him in that water. See, but not one time, watch this, not one time did this man in 38 years look within himself, look within his own capabilities to be whole. Not one time. All he could see was, boy, if I could just get in that water. And since I can't get in that hole, boy, brother, can you please help me? If you could help me just, whatever the angel told me, could you just drop me into the water? His mind was that his healing had to come from that water. Not one time did he look into himself. I won't go there. But his mind was, if I can just get inside of this water, when the water gets troubled or when the angel disturbs it, then all of my problems, all of my troubles are solved. If I can just get there. Watch this. Here's the terrible thing about it. Here's the myth within all of this madness, that every time the water was troubled, you couldn't get it in anyway. So you mean to tell me that your healness is dependent upon who's in front of you, how strong, how much stronger you are than the person ahead of you, or how much, or their deliverance depends on how much weaker you are than they are? So in other words, my healing, my completeness, my wholeness depends on the people that are around me. Yeah. Watch this. Everybody around the pool was in the same shape that he was in. So where was there any room for him to get any help from anybody that was there? I'm coming back there. When you put a period, when you put a comma right there, because I'm coming there. Sometimes you're looking for people around you to help you. How can they help you when they're in the same shape or worse than you in yourself? Not one time did this guy say, if nobody will put me in this pool, I'll crawl into it. If ain't nobody gonna help me to get in there first, by God, I'll roll over into the pool. Not one time did he say that. Not one time did he say, buck this water. If I can't get in the water, then there has to be another way that I can walk. There's gotta be another way that I can get my life back. There's gotta be another way that I can get up off this ground. If I can't get in the water, if the water can't help me, then there has to be another way. Amen. There's gotta be another way. Not one time did he say that. Not one time did he look beyond the miracle, look beyond somebody's help, look beyond government, look beyond where he was living with a system. Not one time did he think he could make it without somebody spoon feeding this table. Yeah. And that's why Lord Jesus asked, do you really want to be whole? Watch this. Then you want to be whole, rise, in other words, get up or do something to help yourself. All right. Say this, it's time to get up.
It's time to get up.
Say it, folks, it's time to get up.
It's time to get up.
I've been down here long enough. I've been wallowing around in this dirt, eating this stuff long enough. Folks been walking by me, kicking dust in my face long enough. It is time for me to take my life. Jeremiah chapter 1, verses 4 through 10. I want you to flip over there real quick. Don't rush me. Now, can I take a little time? Yeah. Kids dance for 20 minutes. Can I have 15 more? Now watch this, beginning at verse 4. Then the word me, Jeremiah says, saying this: before I formed you in your mama's womb, I knew you. And before you came out of your mama, I sanctified you and I ordained you a prophet unto the nations. Hang on this, hang on this. Then said I, Jeremiah said, oh Lord God, behold, I can't speak.
You know the first excuse underlying that,
but I can't speak, for I'm a child.
But look what the Lord says when he dispels that excuse.
But the Lord said unto me, saying, say not that I'm a child. Watch this, and this is where you and I fall in. For thou shalt go to all that I send you. That who sends you? And whatever I command, that shall you speak. That who commands? Be not afraid of their faces. Don't be afraid of your condition. Don't be afraid of what you're facing. Don't be afraid of where you are. For I am with you to deliver you. All right. I'm with you to deliver you. Who said that? Says the Lord. Look at verse 9. Then the Lord put forth his hand, watch this, and he touched my mouth. And the Lord said unto me, behold, I have put my words in your mouth. I have put whose words now? God's words. Where? In my mouth. In your mouth. Your mouth. I have put my words in your mouth. Verse 10. Let's read it together. Read. See, I have this day set you over the nations, over the kingdoms, to root out and to pull down and to destroy and to throw down. Watch this. To build and what? Sound like a new thing God was doing, right? Say, God is doing a new thing. Come on, look at me. Say, God is doing a new thing. So you gotta understand something, man. Where you are right now and where you're gonna stay, God is getting ready to do something new in your life. But the only way God's gonna do a new thing in your life is that it's gonna take a new attitude on your part in order for God to work through. God doesn't work through old stuff. You got to have a mind to want something new. You got to want to help yourself. You got to be tired of where you are. Can I get something? You got to be tired of where you are before God's going to take you down the street. If you're not tired of where you are, I can take you down there, but you'll walk right back. But until you get tired, it makes sense to me giving your ride. But the moment you get tired, the moment red light. She did something, but overeat. somebody to give you a life. You got it within you to create your own life. I can change my own life.
All right.
And it starts with an attitude to do the right thing. Yeah. In 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 7, Apostle Paul, one of the greatest evangelists, I think, in all of the scriptures. He said that he had a thorn, you see, that was in his flesh. You know, some problem. And I'm so glad he didn't mention what his problem was either. He had something wrong with him, some temptation. Something was broken in his experience. Whatever it was, he said that the devil gave it to him. I was so glad to read that. That the devil gave it to Paul, because I said, my God, I knew the devil had me locked in Durham County. And I said, I'm glad that I won't about nothing. I'm glad to see that he was the guy that wrote most of the New Testament. And the first thing he said was that there's something wrong with me, and the devil gave it to me so that I wouldn't think that I was all that. But that is true. Ain't that something? This is what I say. I said, now if Paul, who wrote most of the New Testament, and he was indeed a great man. Well, now if the devil could do that to him, if the devil could attack him to distract him from his greatness, how is it then? How do you not know that where you are right this moment, with all the mess you've been going through and fighting with for 30-some years, or 40-some years, with the pain that you've had to endure, with those who walk out of your life, with the disappointments that you've had to encounter, some you brought on yourself, how do you know that the state that you're in right now was not Satan-induced to distract you from your greatness? Go! comes here. Notice, Paul asked the Lord to remove his thorn. Verse 8, three times. Lord, get me out of this mess. Get me out of this thorn. Heal my body. Send my husband. Send my wife back home. Get me out of jail, out of bankruptcy, out of economic despair. Get me out of grief. Get me out of worry. Lord, remove it, remove it, remove it, remove it. I'm broken. I need a miracle.
And the Lord said, look at him and said, no. I'm not going to take anything away from you at all. But Lord, you just said the devil did it. I know the devil did it, but I'm not going to remove it. Look at verse 9. The Lord told Paul, said, no, sir. You don't need a miracle because my grace or my favor is sufficient. In other words, be able to use my name is the only thing you don't need. Understand, Lord, you don't need a miracle. You don't need water to be a river for you to be here. You don't need somebody to pour oil on you. You don't need to send money off a $99 prophecy. You don't need to congregate in front of some miracle tent. You don't need a miracle. All you need is the grace of God. Because in my son's name, because in my son's name, you can ask what you will of me, and it shall be done for you. You ain't gotta ask in the prophet's name. You ain't gotta ask in the pastor's name. You ain't gotta ask in the name of money. All you got to do in order to get your life back is to ask me in my son's name.
Amen.
Amen. Is the name of my son.
Yes.
Praise the name of the Lord. In fact, the Lord said that my strength, you got to hear what he says here to Paul. He says, my strength or my power is made perfect when you are weak.
Yes.
Wait. It's a setup. Watch this. The Lord is saying that when you are weak, that's when I'm really shown to be powerful. What are you saying? That if you weren't weak, you would never know how strong I am. What are you saying, Lord? I'm saying that because you got sick, now you know I can heal you.
Yeah. Amen.
Because you were troubled, now you know I can deliver you.
Yeah.
Because you didn't have, now you know I can supply all of your needs.
Yeah.
Which means the weaker you are, the more powerful I am. Wait until you lose everything you got. And then the Lord shows up and says, are you ready now? Yes, Lord, I'm ready now. Anything you want, Lord, I'm ready. And that's why he lets the devil spank some of us sometimes. Because whenever we get to the point that nothing else will work, we have nowhere we can turn but to the Lord. That's when we can hear him down. That's when we can call upon his name. That's when he can order our steps upon his feet. And you thought it was called the devil that you got arrested. It was coincidental that you got shot at. You thought it was coincidental that you lost a loved one. No! It was all a setup of the Lord to let you know how much you need him. And the weaker you are, the stronger he is.
Yes.
Today is, I was going to give you the other part of the statement. What Lord Jesus wants us to know today is that
Brokenness as well as wholeness is an attitude. You may be down now, and it doesn't matter how you got there, how long you've been there, but you don't have to stay there.
Amen.
You ain't got to stay there. Lord Jesus told that crippled man, he said, now get up. He didn't say get into the water. He didn't say roll over until you hit the pool. He didn't stop fussing the boss saying, well, you could have never had your finger, like I was showing you last time, I think. You could have never had your finger ready to dip down into something when it started talking about. Just say none of that. The Lord just said, get up. Somebody say, get up.
Get up.
You know, he said, get up and make an effort to do something for yourself.
Yes.
Get up. Make an effort.
Yes.
To do something for yourself.
Yes.
I know we like to run and jump sometimes, but let me tell you something. When you are hurting and going through, when you're about to lose your house, you don't feel like shouting and dashing here. If so, it's hypocritical. People say, well, just praise your way through. Well, I understand that because I preached on that myself. But there come a time in your life when your praise has been hushed by your circumstances because you are troubled as opposed to being free.
Yes.
I'm talking to the real church now.
Yes.
Come on, don't shout me now. I'm talking to the real people.
Yes.
Look at how long you've been saved. There's something come up in your life that will have you to the point that if the Lord doesn't step in, you will lose your natural bone mass. Am I talking to somebody? Lord, don't want to be in you. You'll be scared crazy before daybreak. God has saved a whole lot of us.
Yes.
We're still in our right mind.
Yes.
In the middle of all the hell that we went through. Not in the middle of our trouble. Middle of our circumstances.
Amen.
Hey. God, step in.
Send your resume to this person. Invest your money into this. God ain't gonna always send you a message in a bottle. You got to figure some stuff out for yourself.
Yes.
You got to make an effort.
Yes. Amen.
You got to get up and do something. You got to be resourceful.
Right.
Why must God tell you everything to do to save you when God already told you that it's in you from the start?
Amen.
Before I made you, I already packed you slack full of greatness. Now why I got to sit down and tell you what to do? Start searching your own greatness. Search for your own ability. Search within yourself. See what you're good at. See what makes you happy. If you search within yourself, you will find me. Search within yourself, you'll find the Lord. That's the message for us today. What are we doing to help ourselves to be whole? What are we doing to regain our control over our own life? In other words, do something. Do something! Don't just sit there and wait on God. Do something! Old folks used to say, if you make one step, God will make two. What they were really saying here, watch me, what they were really saying here is this. You make an effort to do something and God will see you through it. But if you don't get up and go do something, God ain't got nothing to work with you. Pastor, now what you talking about? Didn't James tell you that faith without doing something is dead? In order for God to bless where you are, if you're not doing anything, God doesn't have anything to work with.
Yeah.
Believe God, but then get up and go do something to help yourself.
Amen.
You're smart.
Yes.
You're resilient. You can bounce back.
Yes.
You've been demonstrating and marching and carrying on. Thank God for it. But you got to sometimes stop marching and go to work.
Amen.
the Red Sea. But unless God's got a reason for you to walk across on dry land, that water gonna stay together. Yeah.
Can I talk to you? Am I talking to real people?
But what you gotta look at is look at your situation and say, now, what can I do to help myself? You gotta have something to pray for. Lord, what can I do, Lord? You order my steps according to your word. But Lord, here's my plan. You gotta start looking at the ability that you do have. I may not be able to walk, but can I crawl? Well, then I'll try to crawl. If I don't have the ability to crawl, can I inch along like an inchworm? If I don't have that, will somebody bring me a wheelchair? The thing is that I get in motion.
Look, if they don't hire you, what did I tell you? Hire yourself. The people who speak a little different than you, they ain't got no patent on pine straw. You can rake some straw, find you a side of the road and rake up some straw. If they don't hire you, hire yourself. Detail a car, by God. Rake somebody. Say, how much you want to rake my yard, sir? Oh, yes, ma'am, I can rake it for $15. Oh, my God. The last guy charged me $75, yes, ma'am, but I'm just trying to build a name in the neighborhood. I'll do it for $15. They ain't got to know that you broke and poor and disgusting. All they got to know is that you undercut their God. What you're trying to do is eat. You're trying to help yourself. Sit the whole time, man, I wouldn't work for them, man. What you doing, boss? What kind of job you got? If you ain't got no money at all, what does it matter what he's doing? They come here and they work for 2 hours an hour. Well, you broke, you tell them, okay, sir, I'll undercut them for $1.75.
Help me,
what is it? Yeah, help me. Somebody help me here. Now watch this. If he or she left you and took their income with them, bump them, let them go. Look, watch this. Get a second job and downsize. Get a second job and downsize. Can I have 5 more minutes? Get a second job. Downsize. So he left. So she moved out. So she took her income with you. That don't mean that your life depends on the second income. Go out and get another job and help yourself. Move into a cheaper apartment. If you can't, move into your car. But I just think if I beg you to come back and help me do anything.
I was going to say John Brown, but I can't say that.
Take your money with you, and don't you come back no more. Are y'all hearing what I'm saying? If corporate America shuts down, then take a trade position. If you can't get your corporate executive position, take a skilled job, a trade position. If you can't go to four-year school, go to technical college. But do something to help yourself. It's an attitude thing. Better yet, it's an effort thing. If you try to help yourself, then somebody else will be willing to give you a hand. But can't nobody give you a hand until you do something for yourself. Get up! You leave this place today, they said, what Pastor talked about? Pastor hollered at me and spit all over the book in the first 3 rows and told them to get up! Because it's time to get up. Say it with me. It's time to get up! Say it again. It's you've been down too long. People talking about you like a dog. It's time for you to get up and do something for yourself. Galatians chapter 6, verse 9 says, don't be weary in well-doing. In other words, do the right things. You ain't got to sell dope to make a living. You ain't got to prostitute yourself to make a living. And when you're shacked up with somebody that you're not married to, you ain't doing nothing but prostituting yourself. Call it what you want to. You're living with somebody you ain't married to. You're a prostitute. Why are you there? For the check. For them to pay half the bill. If they don't want to give you a ringy, no! Don't be weary and well doing. Do the right thing. And in due season, which means after a while, you shall reap if you don't faint or if you don't give up. God already knows. God's watching you. He's seeing what you're doing to help yourself. And whenever you've gone so far trying to help yourself, then here comes God. He steps right in. First thing he does is he says, hey, baby, I'm here with you. I was with you when you messed your life up. I saw all the tears that you shed. I saw you when you lost everything you had. And you were crying, and I was right there.
it wasn't time yet for me to pull you through. You had to go through. You got to know that there are consequences for bad decisions. So I let you go through. But the whole time you were going through, the good thing about it, baby, is that you didn't stop. I was bringing you right on through. I was telling you through. See, that's the thing that you're going through. The fact is, you don't want to stop. You want to keep going through. And God was with you when you messed up, before you messed up. He saw the pain while you were going through. And the whole time, God was right there with you. And when you change your mind, God changed your heart. And God created you a clean heart. And we knew it might still be in you. And what the Lord is doing now is saying, look, I forgive you for everything you've ever done. It's like it never happened before. Now I know your heart is right. Now I know you want to live a holy life. Now I know you got it within you. Now I know that you want to go to the next level. Now I know you want to live a holy life. I know that when I bring you out this time, you will never go back to that mess again. And so the Lord is saying, now is the time when you receive my faith. And when you receive my faith and turn from your wicked ways. Your survival does not depend on what's around you. Your survival does not depend on the people that are around you. Sometime in order for you to come out of where you are, you got to make some changes here first. And watch this. Sometimes you got to change locations. Look this. Jesus said in John 5 verse 8, the Lord said, rise and watch this. Take up your bed and watch it and walk. What are you saying, Lord? Take up everything. Get rid of everything that tries to hold you back. You know, you can't always let everybody go. Some people are there, but let me tell you this. Remember I said this is an attitude thing, this is an effort thing. I can be around you and not be there. I can see you and not see you. I can hear you and not be listening. We can be in the same house, but not in the same place. Because where you are, I left there some time ago. I can smile, but on the inside, my mind, in some ways. Everybody know what I'm talking about? Let me give you some scriptures and I gotta let you go home. Philippians chapter 4 verse 13 says this, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. That's the message for us today. Hey, you tried yourself, that failed. Try Jesus. You tried everything else. Let's try Jesus now. Romans chapter 8 verse 28, all things work together for good to those who love God and to those who are called according to the Lord's purpose. You want to do what is right? Lord, I want to do it your way now and not my way. The Lord says, hey, you're ready now. I'm ready to take you to the next level. Romans chapter 8 verse 31. If God be for us, who or what can be against us? Hey, folks, if God is for you, they can't stop you. Amen. I said they can't stop you. Amen. You wasting your time, honey girl. You can't stop me. I'm on my way. Somebody shout, I'm on my way.
I'm on my way.
I'm getting up out of here. I don't know where I'm going. The Lord is taking me. One thing I do know, I ain't staying here. 1 John chapter 4, verse 4. For greater is he who is within me than he who is in this world. And so what are you saying to us, Pastor? I'm saying that if you're ready to change, change is already there. If you want to get up from where you are, all you gotta do is make the effort. When you take that first step, like the old folks say, God will pick you up and take two more. Whenever you reach out to God, the Bible says, draw near to the Lord, and the Lord will draw near to you. When you open up your arms and lift your arms up before the Lord and say, Father, I've made a mess of my life. I need you now. Before the Lord even reaches down to grab your hand, he got to first set you down because he was carrying you all the time. How do you think
Amen.
God bless you. Hug somebody beside you and say, hey, get up. Let's do this.